people didn't want to believe that they could be healthy in the morning and dead by nightfall. They didn't want to believe that.
On Monday, March 11th, 1918, just shortly before breakfast, an Army private entered the Fort Riley Camp Hospital, complaining of fever, sore throat, and headache. Soon after, another soldier entered with similar complaints. By noon that day, the hospital had 100 ill soldiers, all with the same symptoms. By the end of the week, there were 500. That spring, 48 men died from what they decided must be pneumonia. Not long after it arrived at Fort Riley, the virus seemed to completely disappear. The healthy men were sent off to fight the war raging in Europe, and soon realized that the virus had not disappeared. They had carried it with them. Men from all sides were being infected. The virus mutated, becoming even more deadly. The mutated virus came back with the soldiers to the United States, and then the trouble really began.
I saw hundreds of young, stalwart men in uniform coming into the wards of the hospital. Every bed was full, yet others crowded in. The faces wore a bluish cast. A cough brought up the blood-stained sputum.
The following is from a letter written by a doctor stationed at Camp Devens in Massachusetts. It gives us a little taste of what the influenza was like. Camp Devens is near Boston and has about 50,000 men, or did before this epidemic broke loose. It also has the base hospital for the division of the Northeast. This epidemic started about 4 weeks ago and has developed so rapidly that the camp is demoralized and all ordinary work is held up till it is passed. All assemblages of soldiers taboo. These men start with what appears to be an attack of la grippe or influenza. And when brought to the hospital, they very rapidly develop the most vicious type of pneumonia that has ever been seen. 2 hours after admission, they have the mahogany spots over the cheekbones. And a few hours later, you can begin to see the cyanosis extending from their ears and spreading all over the face, until it is hard to distinguish the colored men from the white. It is only a matter of a few hours, then, until death comes. It is simply a struggle for air until they suffocate. It is horrible. One can stand it to see 1, 2, or 20 men die. But to see these poor devils dropping like flies sort of gets on your nerves. We have been averaging about 100 deaths per day and still keeping it up. There is no doubt in my mind that there is a new mixed infection here, but what, I don't know. My total time is taken up hunting Rawls dry or moist, sibilant or crepitant, or any other of the 100 things that one may find in the chest. They all mean but one thing here, pneumonia. And that means, in about all cases, death. The influenza was spread by simply breathing. No one could stop it. Everyone needs to breathe. Up until the outbreak of this virus, it had seemed that doctors could cure anything. It didn't take long to realize that this was not the case. Doctors were helpless. People's names were on body bags shortly after they arrived with the symptoms. It was usually those who looked healthy that would be spreading the virus. People started wearing masks in public and gargling, and spitting had even been outlawed. But the death toll continued to rise. When things were just starting to get bad, authorities seemed to just deny it was happening. The war was still on in Europe, and troops and help were still needed. One day, federal officials called in 13 million men to register for the draft. They were all forced to cram into small buildings, making the spread of the virus all too easy. In Philadelphia, 200,000 people crowded the streets to support Liberty loan drives. In the days that followed, the virus spread like wildfire, leading into October, the influenza's deadliest month in the United States. October of 1918 turned out to be the deadliest month in the nation's history. People everywhere were coming down with the flu. There were reports in Philadelphia of 4,597 deaths in just 1 week. In New York, there were 869 dead in a single day. It got to the point where funerals were no longer practiced. People would have to request boxes to put their dead in on their front porches, and then an open truck would come by and collect the bodies. By the end of the month, the flu had killed over 195,000 Americans. As one doctor in Washington declared, if the epidemic continues its mathematical rate of acceleration, civilization could disappear from the face of the earth. Luckily, though, after its peak in October, the number of new cases started to decline. Very early in November, the virus had already virtually disappeared from many cities. It seemed to have run out of people to infect. Though traces of the virus would last into 1919, by mid-November, it appeared that the worst was over, and life began to return to normal. In just 10 months, the Spanish influenza killed about 600,000 Americans. Around the globe, the numbers reached to at least 30 million dead. The virus affected a majority of the human species. So why has this tragedy been so easily forgotten?
It is in the individual memory of a great many of us, but it's not in our collective memory. That, for me, is the greatest mystery, how we could have forgotten anything so horrendous, so massively horrendous as this epidemic, which killed so many of us, killed us so fast, and our reaction was to forget it.
Why? You know, why wasn't that part of our memory or of our history? And I think it's probably because it was so awful while it was happening, so frightening, that people just got rid of the memory, but it always lingers there as a kind of an uneasiness. If it happened once before, what's to say it's not going to happen again? The more we find out about influenza virus, the more real that fear becomes.
The fall of 1918 was a time of horror, a time to forget. But some would always remember.
I remember my mother putting a white sheet, a white piece of cloth over his face, and they closed the casket. I can't forget. It was very, very bad.
The effect of my mother's death was that I realized for the first time in forever that we were not safe. We were not beyond harm. My father did what he could. He kept us together as a family. But from that time on, there was a sadness which had not existed before. And there was a deep down sadness that never quite went away. Because I knew people aren't safe. Nobody is safe. Terrible things can happen to anybody.